Now, Madras High Court Rose Ann Rajan is here with us. I request her to talk about the Tamil Nadu context, and also she has also rescued a lot of victims of trafficking, and she will share her experience right now. Welcome, Advocate Rose Ann.
A very good morning to all of you. I'm extremely sorry for the inordinate delay because I was held up with another event with the police, state police in Tamil Nadu. Thank you so much to all of you for having shared your inputs. And I just heard a few notes that I've heard from Krishnan sir and also from Ruchira ma'am that were really good. Just start with, everybody knows what trafficking is, and everybody is aware of the fact of how cruel things are happening and how invisible it is. And when we see labor trafficking, sex trafficking, and organ trafficking, or even cyber online sexual exploitation of women and children, and also men, mostly men are not considered to be inside the chain of trafficking at all. But I think we should start looking into that aspect as well. The reason why I say this is because in one of the rescue operations that I'd been to, we had brought out everybody, and then there ended up a chaos in the tent of the revenue office where a woman was screaming and shouting and telling that her husband is missing. So we went back to the spot, and then we found this man in a hidden room inside where he was trying to attempt to commit suicide. Then when we asked him, why are you trying to commit suicide? Did you not know we were screaming out for people? We brought out so many of them, and we took all of them to the revenue office, and where were you? Then he said he never heard anything of it because he was seated in that room and he was crying out loud. Then I wanted to ask him what actually drove him to commit suicide and what actually drove him to cry his heart out so loud that he couldn't even hear a megaphone where people were screaming and asking if there was anybody else left back inside. Then he happened to tell me this. He said, in my presence, the people who have owned us, that is the traffickers, would call my wife to sleep with them. And I had tried to fight it all by myself, but I couldn't. And at least if I had committed suicide, I thought my wife would go back to do the funeral rites and then she would be free. So please do consider all gender, include transgenders into the subject matter also, which we fail to see. We also fail to see that many people who are disabled also could be trafficked, because the vulnerability level is very high with reference to people who are under situations of that sort. So let's just come out of the box that just poverty alone drives people to be trafficked, which is not the case. And in a situation like this, as in COVID, there are many people who are actually put to a Hobson's choice. A Hobson's choice goes on to say that you do not have an option for your livelihood, and so you're driven to a stage that whatever is being provided before you, you take it for yourself, and you feel that is your fate and you have to live it. So when people get trafficked into circumstances like these, they actually feel that there is no way out. So what could actually drive or bring in that kind of an awareness is trying to flag off things every now and then, bringing it to the knowledge of people who are also there at the villages. I would like to draw your attention to a judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court, where the Supreme Court feels that even the village panchayat level leaders should be in touch with in the whole circle if you really want to combat an issue as trafficking. What we fail to see is that we target the particular district, we get in information, we do the rescue, we leave. Or we work with the state government, we ensure that the processes happen on time and we leave. But we do not see whether this is being addressed at every level. most importantly, even children could be people who could give us information. We fail to see that. We actually fail to see how we can garner the support of every citizen by creating an awareness of how human trafficking should be combated at each and every person's level. It could be a conversation also. And most importantly, what we also fail to look at is where we need to ensure that people understand that if they are there in any part of the enforcement wings, or if they are given a responsibility, as in, say, labor trafficking, the revenue department, or it could be the police with reference to immoral trafficking prevention. Down the line, it could be officials on the top who could know or be aware of all information with reference to trafficking. But down the line, do people know? Are we creating that awareness amongst them? See, at the end of the day, everybody knows that, you know, ignorance of law is not an excuse at all. It also applies for the victim. But the victim is in a state that even if he or she knows, they do not know whom to approach. So in our awareness, or even in the ways how we get to work together, I think we should also bring about the fact of communicating who are the appropriate people. Tomorrow, I might be there, I may not be there. So it is the case with everybody. When we put them online with where they have to touch base with, that is when solution starts. That is when anybody can put this and set the law in motion. Let me also draw your attention to the fact that non-compliance of duty or non-compliance of attending to an issue of trafficking should also be communicated, that it is an impact on the state and the chief secretary himself. There has been an order that has been passed by the Honorable Supreme Court to the Ministry of Home Affairs, where it goes on to say that the chief secretary has to turn in a report on human trafficking. I am afraid if that is happening, this was a judgment that was passed probably in 2011. I can even share that judgment with you all through the organizers. So are we actually seeing such orders, strong, stringent orders that are being passed for proper implementation being implemented by itself? And even as I see many people, in very influential people in this fora, I would like to reiterate that unless and until we all work together as one, the issue cannot be resolved. Why I say this is because everybody is unique in their own strength of working, and it is very important that we know our strengths and work on our strengths to actually bring an end to this form of trafficking. And most importantly, even as we work together, I think we should also be very vigilant of trying to even know or get an information of who are the people who are implementers of the law. Where only when a crisis comes, we tend to go and approach the influencers of the law, or try to even figure out who the influencers of the law are, who are the enforcers. So it's very important to actually garner that support also. With reference to trafficking issues and rescuing trafficking victims, the biggest challenge that has been is providing accommodation for them. For labor trafficking also, it's relatively okay to actually put them in a, say, mandap that is available or a school that is available. But when you see victims of sex trafficking, it's even more we are again putting them into a vulnerable situation where the fear is high, the intimidation could be high as compared to labor trafficking. But if you actually weigh both, they are on the same scale on a very different note. There is no less or more with reference to trafficking. All trafficking victims undergo the very same amount of fear, very same amount of trauma, and the immediate support of trauma care is something that we fail to address, which we have to see that the state governments and the officials utilize the people who are experienced professionals in psychosocial rehabilitation, because that is something which is very important, be it from the start of an investigation to the end of a case. So if we really want to see or make people understand that this is an offense that will not be taken lightly, as the Supreme Court has called it out, we certainly need to ensure that we see those good amount of convictions. Now, as a lawyer, why do we not see convictions? Is one, because there is a tendency that if in case they are from a different state, it is difficult to get them. Or if they are there in a different country, it is difficult to get them. Or if they are people who could escape. Let me give you a scenario. There was a friend of mine who was working on a trafficking case. And when he had to go get back the particular victim to testify at court, he asked for permission to use the restroom and he left that place. And that whole hearing went off. And it took a long time to even find out that, you know, where he was. The whole day was gone. And we couldn't answer back the court. See, what kind of fear factor is there within them is something that we ought to know. And we should negate that fear. And at the same time, we should also use the support of the legal services, where they are responsible as per the NALSA guidelines to ensure that they help victims of trafficking walk through the journey of the legal prosecution. Post-prosecution, post-period of the trial starting, and also pre-prosecution. In the pre-prosecution stage, there is a tendency of fear for any victim of trafficking to see a uniformed police official. In sex trafficking and POXO cases, you can actually, not in ITPA, but in POXO, you can actually see statements being mentioned that police officials should not be in uniform. I think the very same applies also for labor trafficking and also for ITPA matters. The reason why I mentioned this is because any person who's well-dressed, they themselves have this intuition that they are people who are friends of the traffickers. So for us also, if people would have over here who have gone for rescue operations of any kind, any forms of trafficking, would really understand what I'm trying to say. That when you go to get these people out, it is very difficult for them to have trust in you and to come out. So in case if we would have had that amount of support from the panchayat level to the officials over there, or people working in and around that area who could communicate to them or build that trust in them, it is easier even for the victims to actually speak out in boldness. So this statement in boldness does not just help during investigation, but also pre-investigation from the time we rescue them and take down their statements. So my earnest request to this fora would be if we could actually garner the support and bring about a chain of people that we need to have from this fora and also out of this fora to actually bring a system in place where we can ensure that every kind of support that is required is being given. In case if there is, there are people or there are victims who have been tortured to an extent that they become impaired of hearing or impaired of sight or even cannot communicate, there should be very different ways, innovative ways of actually getting their statements out. So that will help them also communicate the trauma that they've undergone, the actual facts that they've undergone. And something that we really miss in all of these trafficking cases is that we don't go back to the trafficking whole chain and find out where is the recruiter, who is the transporter, who is the harborer, who is the transferer. We only see the receiver. We only see the receiver. We only see the person who is a supervisor to them at the maximum. We do not go any way beyond the receiver or beyond the people who are involved in exploitation at the destination point. Unless and until we go back to the initial phase of where from where they were, they have been trafficked and bring them to prosecution, it is not going to help us find a total solution. And on a day as this, I urge each and every one of you, as in wherever you'll work on any issue, try to go back to see the roots of where this issue started. It is very important if we really want to curb the issue of trafficking. And in case if we are not going to track back to the recruiter or even to the people, agents who are involved in the mid-phase, we are missing out a big chunk. And we will continue to be rescuing people from trafficking, but we will still be doing it without seeing an end to this issue. So as we team up to see how better we can work towards trafficking, I would urge each and every one of you to gather that information. We may not be able to get specific details, but some information like a name could also matter. In cases of certain NGOs, I have seen the very same trafficker's name being mentioned by the victim over and over again. What does that say? That says that even if we rescue them, there's going to be another lot that is going to come into that very same place. So please be open to getting that information. And even when we get in touch with officials who are supposed to be enforcers of the law, I think it's very important that we also communicate to them the seriousness and the need of actually going back to see where they have been trafficked and what has happened. Lastly, to finish, I would like to quote again the Supreme Court on the point of rehabilitation. There are many shelter homes, as I already mentioned, that for bonded labor or for labor trafficking or for any other forms of trafficking other than sex trafficking, we may not feel it a threat of putting them in places where it could be a mandap or any other open area. But I think we have to also have specific, good, reputed, government-run shelter homes that can actually be a space, like a society where people who do not have an option for livelihood can also be provided with the needs and requirements from the state government. This might be a very big thought, but unless and until we actually move towards bringing a community, a space where we can have all of them lodged in safety, it's going to be very hard for us to retain that trust until we see an end of the prosecution of the case. Because all of that that happens to them at that given point of time is something that will go along with them till they walk through the face of prosecution. So it is very important that we look into our shelter homes, look into the functions of the shelter homes, look into the ways how shelter homes are treating the inmates also, which is very important. And of course, yes, the Supreme Court has made the District Legal Services Authority and State Legal Services Authority as the nodal agency to look into the same. So I think we even need to work along with them to see how a submission can be made to the government through them to see how and if we can have a shelter space for victims of trafficking per se and not mingle them with the others. So I once again thank you all for this forum, and I hope we will all get to work together And soon, you know, there are very few flaws, but in those few flaws, we will have to just see a little more perfection. Together is when we can see this perfection, and together I'm very certain that we will see the curbing of human trafficking during our lifetime. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Advocate Rose.